In this video, we'll look at how Ethereum works and explain various terms you'll come across while using Ethereum, such as smart contracts, gas limit, block rewards, and supply of Ether. We'll also look at the purpose behind each of these aspects. A quick side note before we get started. If you find this helpful, please subscribe to show your support for this type of content and also to get updates on future videos. Now, let's dive in. Ethereum is the first general purpose blockchain and the native currency of Ethereum is Ether. But first, what's a general purpose blockchain and why do we need one? When Bitcoin started gaining momentum, people recognized the potential of blockchain to offer more services in a decentralized manner. Then, new blockchains started propping up for different use cases, like Namecoin for distributed DNS, etc. Having a blockchain specific for each application is similar to having an internet only for emails, another internet only for video streaming, and so on. Obviously, that's very inefficient. So, we have a single internet on which anyone can launch applications with different use cases. This is essentially the idea behind Ethereum. One blockchain on top of which anyone can deploy new applications. These applications are called smart contracts. A smart contract is simply a program that runs on the blockchain. There are many real-world transactions where you need a trusted intermediary to ensure both parties fulfill their obligations. The idea behind a smart contract is to define the role of these trusted intermediaries using code running on the blockchain. Now, the contract can fulfill the transaction when both parties meet their obligations. Here is an example of what a smart contract looks like for basic data storage. The smart contracts on Ethereum are Turing complete, which means they're able to compute just about anything given enough resources. DApps, short for decentralized applications, provide the visual interface through which users can access functionality from different smart contracts on the blockchain. These are like the mobile or web apps we use today, except it's very hard to take down a DApp. In Ethereum, new blocks are created about every 13 seconds. A shorter block time translates to a higher chance of duplicate blocks from different miners. The blocks that are part of the main chain will get the block reward, and the ones that didn't make it to the main chain could become an uncle block, and it gets the uncle block reward, which is smaller than the block reward. If you'd like to learn more about the reasons behind uncle blocks, check out the Ghost protocol from the Ethereum white paper linked below. New tokens are issued in the form of block rewards, currently set to 2 Ether per block and an additional 1.7 Ether per uncle block. Ethereum doesn't have a fixed supply like Bitcoin. The current inflation rate is approximately 4.5%. The Ethereum community believes that a steady, predictable inflation is crucial to keeping the blockchain secure well into the future. And Ethereum's monetary policy is best described as minimum issuance to secure the network. The upcoming ETH 2.0 transition aims to gradually decrease the inflation rate, but that's a topic for another time. Similar to Bitcoin, Ethereum uses proof-of-work consensus. So, to mine a new block, nodes must find a solution to a mathematical problem. One major difference here is Ethereum uses ETH-ASH while Bitcoin uses SHA-256. There's a very good reason for adopting a different hash function to Bitcoin. ETH-ASH is designed in a way that it's hard to come up with custom mining hardware such as ASICs for Bitcoin mining. This is because ETH-ASH relies on access to lots of high-speed memory, like the kind offered by the graphic cards in most computers today. The idea is that if you manage to come up with a custom chip that is faster than the graphic cards, you're better off switching your business model to making graphic cards, as that's a much bigger addressable market. This is why it is still possible to mine Ethereum using gaming PCs today. The goal is to keep mining more accessible to everyone and combat some of the centralization issues surrounding Bitcoin mining. Each account on Ethereum has a unique 20-byte address and contains four pieces of information: a nonce, which is a counter to prevent the same transaction from being processed more than once; the current Ether balance; smart contract code, if it is present; and account storage, which is empty by default. The first two are common across almost all blockchains, and the last two are related to smart contracts. In general, there are two types of accounts: externally owned accounts, which are controlled by private keys. These are like accounts for humans, and smart contract accounts, which are controlled by their contract code. Think of these as bot accounts. When you interact with a smart contract, it is executed by every node on the Ethereum network. The execution takes place inside an Ethereum virtual machine, which is a specialized environment that limits what information is available to the smart contract. The code in the contract doesn't have access to internet, files, or generally anything that is external to the blockchain itself. It has limited access to other smart contracts and information that's already on the blockchain. These limitations are essential to ensure that we get the same result when the smart contract is executed by any other node under identical conditions. However, if you are writing a smart contract that needs access to external data, say the price of Tesla stock, you can use oracles. Oracles are third-party services that provide smart contracts with external information. They serve as bridges between blockchains and the outside world. Transactions on Ethereum can involve more than just sending Ether between accounts. You can also create a transaction that calls a specific function on a smart contract. Every transaction consists of the following info: account address of the receiver, signature of the sender, optional data to pass to the smart contract, gas limit, and gas price. To better understand the last two items and the economics of smart contract execution, let's take an analogy from the real world. Suppose you are going on a road trip from point A to point B. Your car runs on gas and there is no refueling on the way. So you have to decide upfront how much gas you are going to put in, and that depends on the distance between point A and point B. And you have to pay for that gas using local currency such as dollars. The total amount of gas required for the trip can vary depending on environmental conditions, etc. The price per unit of gas will also vary depending on the demand at the time. So, the cost of the trip in dollar terms depends on the amount of gas required and the price per unit of gas. Now, going back to the blockchain world, transactions on Ethereum can take different amounts of computational work. When creating a transaction, you have to set the gas limit, which is the maximum amount of gas your transaction is allowed to consume, and the gas price, which is the price you're going to pay per unit of gas used by your transaction. Gas prices are typically measured in gigawei. Wei is the smallest unit of Ether. The gas limit is important to prevent a transaction from taking more computation than you would expect and depleting your Ether balance. The gas price comes in handy during periods of high demand to use the blockchain. Miners have an incentive to process transactions with higher gas price because they can get more Ether per unit of computation. If you set a gas limit that's too low, your transaction could halt before completion and all steps performed so far will be rolled back. In this case, you still pay for the gas used before halting. Compared to our earlier analogy, this is similar to running out of gas in the middle of your trip. You haven't made your trip, but you would still have to pay for the gas used. If this happens, you can always try again by setting a higher gas limit. The dApp you're using generally recommends how much gas each function is expected to consume, so you don't have to go around guessing unless you really want to. Just like with Bitcoin, blocks on Ethereum also have a size limit. Each block must stick to the block gas limit, which is set by the miners and the network collectively. The total amount of gas expended by all transactions in the block must be less than the block gas limit. The block gas limit at block 0 was initialized to 5000. Any miner who mines the next block can change the block gas limit by up to 0.1% in either direction from the parent block gas limit. Currently, this is at 12.5 million. And that's all the basics of how Ethereum works. Smart contracts have unlocked a world of possibilities on blockchain with different classes of applications, innovating in decentralized finance, decentralized governance, token systems, NFTs, etc. And I'll cover these topics in future videos. With that, we're almost out of time. If you have any questions or suggestions, let me know in the comment section. And also, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button if you like to get updates for future videos. Thanks for watching. My name is Praveen, and I'll see you again soon.